hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, was a powerful democratic statement. And although Jefferson would not have applied it to women or to Indians or to blacks, nonetheless, in all of those cases, those words would come back to be very serviceable for those groups in pushing civil rights and civil liberties forward in the United States from where Jefferson's statement left them. The problem with the Declaration of Independence was that once independence was won from Britain, then the question became one of governance. How were these former colonies of Britain to govern? What led immediately to the Constitutional Convention in 1787 were a series of uprisings by debtors, essentially, not just in Massachusetts. The most famous is, of course, the Shays Rebellion in 1786.
The American state was founded largely to get the Ohio Valley, largely to cross the Appalachians. The Constitution, to organize an army and money in order to conquer further lands more to the west. That's the origin of the USA. But to do that, the slave masters are not going to do the fighting. What they will do is hire poor people to do it. But when they don't pay the poor people, as they didn't pay Daniel Shays, Daniel Shays takes matters into his own hands in 1787 and goes to the courts and shuts down the courts because the courts were beginning to foreclose on the grounds that Daniel Shays and the other veterans from the American War of Independence did not have the money to pay back.
Debtor riots were happening throughout the 1780s, and they were sufficiently scary from the point of view of people with property that they had to do something about it. And what they did about it was essentially overthrow the Articles of Confederation and instill a much stronger, much more able government to protect the property interests that were in dire threat from the people, quote unquote. This was an elitist, you could almost say, coup d'etat, except there wasn't any strong central government to launch a coup against. They were really trying to set one up and protect it against majoritarian interests, especially economic interests, especially property interests, especially threats from people who didn't have much. First thing they did when they got to Philadelphia in 1787 was they locked the doors. The only reason we know what happened behind those closed doors were that people like James Madison kept extensive notes.
The American Constitution was formulated primarily by James Madison. He's the major framer of the Constitution, and he wanted to overcome what he called the tyranny of the majority. He said a primary goal of government is to ensure that the opulent are protected from the majority. So therefore he designed the Constitution in such a way that, as he put it, the wealth of the nation will be in charge. The more responsible set of men, those who sympathize with property owners and their rights. And the system was designed that way. Power was in the Senate, which was the least representative body, and it was the wealth of the nation. In fact, it still is. The House of Representatives, which is more democratic, in theory, was given much less power. And the powerful executive is also supposed to represent the wealth of the nation. In Madison's defense, one should say that he was really pre-capitalist in his mentality. He assumed that the wealthy would be what he called benevolent gentlemen who would not be concerned with their own interests, but with the benefit of the people. Adam Smith, who preceded him, was much more realistic. He pointed out that the principal architects of policy, namely the merchants and manufacturers in his day, they ensure that policies are designed so that their own interests are protected, no matter how grievous the effect on others, including the people of England. It's rather interesting to compare Madison's thinking, which founded this country, with the first major book on politics, namely Aristotle's Politics. Aristotle surveyed many kinds of systems and decided that of all of them, didn't like any of them, but he said of all of them, democracy is probably the best. But he said that democracy has a problem. And it was the same problem that Madison noticed centuries later. He said if in Athens everyone had a right to vote, the poor majority would attack the property of the rich, insist that it be divided, and he also felt that was unfair. But Madison and Aristotle had opposite solutions. Madison's solution was to restrict democracy. Aristotle's solution was to restrict inequality.
Opponents of the new government were called anti-federalists, though the term is inaccurate. The majority favored some form of federation, but insisted on more localized control with a more participatory democratic system.
The Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, they were the price the Federalists had to pay in the ratifying conventions to pass the document. So the democratic element of the Constitution, which of course is the Bill of Rights, was forced down their throats. It didn't come out of Philadelphia at all. It was appended in 1791 and forced down on the Constitution by the more democratic elements in the society. Even with the Bill of Rights, we have a system which, you know, is hardly perfect from the point of view of civil rights and civil liberties, let's put it mildly. They've trampled all over with the rights of citizens. So the Bill of Rights is hardly an ironclad set of guarantees for civil rights and civil liberties in the United States. But I'd hate to think of the United States without it. The anti-federalists were significantly more partial to democratic elements in the society and to the rights of ordinary people than were the significantly more elitist federalists.
If the greatest legacy of the anti-federalists was the Bill of Rights, their dream of direct democracy was not to be. At the time, many dissidents made predictions for what they believed would come to pass as the new nation grew and flourished. The natural course of power is to make the many slaves to the few, one anti-federalist wrote. Another objected to the new government because the bulk of the people can have nothing to say to it. The government is not a government of the people. The men of fortune would not feel for the common people. An aristocratical tyranny would arise in which the great will struggle for power, honor, and wealth. The poor become a prey to avarice, insolence, and oppression. In short, my fellow citizens, it can be said to be nothing less than a nasty stride to universal empire. A significant model for both the Federalists and Anti-Federalists were the Iroquois, who had created a highly sophisticated and democratic federation of self-governing units. In stark contrast to European forms of government, the Iroquois people had the ability to immediately remove corrupt leaders. Women played a significant role in decision-making. Everyone was permitted to participate in debate and policy formulation.
Native Americans were exceedingly democratic in the way they are. No society is perfect. When you make comparisons, you see that they were sometimes small, but sometimes 30, 40,000 people and more in a large confederacy that operated on a basis of mutual respect. Mutual respect that developed out of experience, because if you didn't treat people equally, then they were going to give you trouble. Societies were exceedingly collaborative, but they were also exceedingly individualist. The individual was honored, but the values were collaborative because you had to get along. Everybody was included in every decision that affected them. Elders obviously were honored. They knew more. You listen to your elders, but everybody had a say. You have an extremely participatory society, and as it moved up to larger, there's a great deal of decentralization. So if you had a large number of people, and they would be in a federation, the village would decide for itself. The tribe would then decide, but the individual villages would have to decide. Then the tribes in the federation, their representatives would meet. But they wouldn't decide for everyone. They'd have to have the consensus of local people. So if there wasn't consensus already, they would have to go back and discuss it. So that to the extent that there was representation, these were representatives who were truly representative. They would have to go back. They wouldn't keep their positions unless they consulted people. And they knew that. Even if they had the authority to make a decision, people would go elsewhere and not keep them as leaders if they didn't listen to them and they didn't treat them. By and large, you had a much more participatory society, and even on the larger, more representative level, the representatives really had to listen to their constituencies.
Ironically referred to as primitive and savage, Native Americans had actually created a far more democratic system of self-governance than any civilized nation in history. But their anarchic models, as well as the more limited democratic systems proposed by the Anti-Federalists, were incompatible with Madison's elitist vision. In republic and parliamentary democracy alike, citizens would be reduced to passive observers. They would be allowed to pick and choose which individual made decisions on their behalf, but they would not be able to make those decisions themselves. Returning to the period after the First World War, we find widespread support amongst intellectuals for Madison's elitist interpretation of democracy. According to Walter Lippmann, the public's function in politics was to be interested spectators of action, but not participants. Yet Lippmann perceived a problem. New technologies in communication and transportation had awakened millions of disenfranchised people to a new world outside their towns and cities, while traditional economic, political, and social structures remained in place. Something had to change. But rather than advocate structural changes in society's institutions, Lippmann suggested that propaganda readjust the public mind.
In his essays on democracy in the 1920s, which are incidentally called Progressive Essays on Democracy, he was a Wilson, Roosevelt, Kennedy liberal in the American sense. He says that the majority are simply incompetent. They are ignorant and meddlesome outsiders, in his view. That's the majority of the population. And to allow them to participate in decision-making would be a complete disaster. So therefore, we have to design means to ensure that what he called the responsible men, of whom he was, of course, one, are protected from the roar and the trampling of the beasts, the ignorant majority. And he devised a number of methods. Lippmann called it the manufacture of consent. We have to manufacture the consent of the ignorant and meddlesome outsiders, mass of the population. And the huge public relations industry was developed at the same time. They are the people who manage and control the marketing exercises that are called elections in the United States. They are marketing exercises, and they're well aware of it.
Apparently we have all been wrong. It is pronounced California. Ladies and gentlemen, the governor of the great state of California, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
So, for example, in the last election, 2008, the advertising industry gives a prize every year for the best marketing campaign of the year. 2008, they gave it to the Obama campaign.